Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are around the globe. Welcome back to Adonai's Kingdom. Welcome to the channel we talk about the Most High God, Adonai, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and we talk about Yeshua, anything pertaining the kingdom of God, the goodness of the kingdom, because there's no badness, nothing bad, everything is good. Okay, welcome. My name is Awaudi, the messenger. Let's start with a word of prayer. Father, Lord, I want to thank you. I want to bless you. I honor you, O Father. I lift up your name, O God. You are the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. We bless you. Father, as we come before you, use me as an oracle of your word. Mold me. Use me to pass the message. I thank you, Lord, for everything. Holy Spirit, I welcome you. You are always welcome in the meeting, anytime. And bless my viewers, listeners, wherever they may be in the globe. Bless them mightily and let them open their ears and hearts and understand the ways of the kingdom. In Yeshua's mighty name I pray and believe. Amen and amen. Well guys, welcome to the seventh month of the year. We are in July, the seventh month. And I don't know about you, but for me, I tend to believe the seventh month in the kingdom of God is unique. I'll just give you a homework. You can Google or you can do some research in the Bible, what happened in the seventh month all over the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation. Just go and see about the seventh month. It was full of blessings, achievements, and that's why I always believe, and I believe that I also I'll be part of that group that achieves, improves, is blessed in the seventh month. And I also pray to God that you might believe, you will believe and be part and parcel of the blessings, the seventh month of the kingdom of God. Welcome back. Today we're going to talk about Deuteronomy 23, and the title of my message today is Excluded but now included. Was excluded, now is included. As usual, it's about the Bible. We are just going step by step, realizing the things that we never knew was in the Bible. So many things were in the Bible. Yeah, we've been reading for years since we were kids, small children. We are in Sunday school, adult Sunday school. You've been in church, but you read the Bible just like any other book. That's why in Adonai's kingdom, we want to go in the deep things, the Holy Spirit to guide us, not man to guide us, but the Holy Spirit to teach us the ways of the kingdom. So in Deuteronomy, that's Devarim in Hebrew 23, I think I'll read Verse 1 to 4. These are the laws that Moses used to give the people of Israel, the Israelites. Verse 1. A man shall not take his father's wife, nor shall he uncover the corner of his father's cloak. That's, we can just say it's respect. respect your parents, respect your father. You know, even you've seen there are places in the Bible whereby there are people who went, found their dad naked, so they had to move backwardly to cover the nakedness. I mean, it's like your dad is holy, just respect him. In short, respect your parents. Okay, verse 2. A man with injured testicles or whose member is cut may not enter the assembly of God, the Lord. This is quite interesting. 3. A bastard shall not enter the assembly of the Lord. That's a child who doesn't know the dad or something. Even the 10th generation shall not enter the assembly of the Lord. These are the laws that they used to be given. Okay, and another one. An Ammonite or Moabite shall not enter the assembly of the Lord. Even the 10th generation shall never enter the assembly of the Lord. And then this was because they did not greet you with bread and water on the way when you left Egypt, and because the people of Moab hired Balaam the son of Beor from Pethom in Aram Naharaim against you to curse you. So it's like these were the Ammonites. The Ammonites and the Moabites were the enemies of Israel. So it's like they were being given conditions not to go anywhere closer to the where the Lord was, the Holy of Holies. And as I was going through these first four verses, things have really changed. Ever since Yeshua came, Jesus came to the world, he opened up the doors for everyone. You know, had Jesus not come, we couldn't be even thinking of being in the presence of God. He changed everything. I just thank God for his son, Yeshua. Jesus came, and now, from the cross, he opened up for us through his death. Now we can go to the Holy of Holies. You, as long as you're clean. He gave us the keys to enter into the kingdom where you can converse. You know, when you speak in tongues, you're already in the kingdom. You are speaking to God. You are already welcomed. These days of Deuteronomy chapter 23 verse 1 to 4. People couldn't imagine anything like that, a normal person to be doing. But now, thank to Jesus Christ, we speak to God as a friend. And that's what the Lord tells us. But still, if you want to go to the presence of the Most High God, you know, there are some conditions, and the conditions are so simple. Let's go to Psalms, the book of Psalm 24. The book of Psalm 24, verse 3 to 6. Psalms 24, verse 3 to 6. Okay, here, listen to what David says. Verse 3. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord, that is in the presence of the Most High God? Who shall ascend? Who'll be there? And who shall stand in his holy place? He's asking now. Who is that? I mean, who's that favored to stand in the holy place of God? Is it the bishop? Is it the pastor? Is it the pastor's wife? Is it the pope? Is it the person who cleans the church? Or is it the president, the king and queens? Or the rich man? Who can enter into the holies? Let's see. Okay. Verse 4. The answer is here. He that has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul in vanity, and who nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and the righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob Selah. That's, and then he says in verse 7, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye over everlasting doors. Your gates are your hands. You open up your gates, everlasting doors. Open up your mouth. Just lift them up, your gates, that your whole body. And then it says, so that the King of glory may come in. And you might ask, who's this King of glory? I thought we were talking about going to the presence of God. Then who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come. Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory, Selah. So, going to the presence of God. Anyone can go to the presence of God. The Bible tells us. God tells us anyone is welcome in my presence. As long as you've got a clean heart, clean hands. I mean, you work according to the laws of the Most High Adonai. With that, you'll be assured to be in his presence. Okay, let's see more about the laws that God was giving the Israelites. So another interesting one was in verse 12 to 15. That's Deuteronomy 23, verse 12 to 15. And he says, it shall be towards evening, he shall bathe in water. When the sun sets, he may come within the camp. Okay. And you have a designated place outside the camp so that you can go out there to use as a privy. And you shall keep a stake in addition to your weapons. And it shall be when you sit down outside to relieve yourself, you shall dig it with it, and you shall return and cover your excrement. Verse number 15. For the Lord your God goes along in the midst of your camp to rescue you and deliver your enemies before you. Therefore, your camp shall be holy, so that he shall not see anything unseemly among you that will turn away from him. So you see, and that thing even I've seen in the African culture, most people, like even me, when I was growing up, and still there are some people in some areas in our villages whereby they've got toilets outside the village, and nobody told them it's supposed to be outside. So sometimes, you know, it just amuses me how our grandparents used to go about it. And I'm like, who lied that our people knew about God when the white man came to Africa? Of which, that was a big fat lie. They knew, they were following the laws of Israel, the laws which were way, way years back, Because like this case of this one, digging pit latrines outside the village, not within. They used to do it. You know, sometimes, you know, that's why we are, it's called Adonai's kingdom. We compare and contrast to see how the world has been surrounding us everywhere. And I'm sure it resonates with some other people also, some other cultures. It depends if your people used to, maybe toilets used to be outside the village. And when it comes to this, the Holy Spirit showed me it's the same as your body. You know, toilets being away, your body, you have to remove the evil thoughts, the evilness that's within you. Just discard them completely so that the Lord may visit you. The Lord doesn't want a dirty place. He doesn't want a dirty mind, dirty heart. He wants a clean soul so that he can move. You see, here he said, when we are talking of their villages in verse 15, he said, "For the Lord your God goes along in the midst of your camp to rescue you and deliver your enemies before you." So, the same thing, if you are clean, the Lord God will go along amidst your camp, is your body, to rescue you. He'll be there for you to rescue you and deliver you from your enemies. So that means the dirt that you have, cleanse yourself. Pray to the Holy Spirit. Seek guidance. Walk according to the laws of the Most High, and He will guide you. He'll take control of you. Okay, verse 19. Let's see another law. In verse 19, you shall not bring a prostitute. You shall not bring a prostitute's fee. Sorry, first verse 18, let's start from verse 18. There shall not be a prostitute of the daughters of Israel, and there shall not be a male prostitute of the sons of Israel. So you see, prostitution, God is against prostitution. Whatever you do. You know, it's interesting because imagine if you are a prostitute and then you get kids. One day, 10 years down the line, 20, 15 years down the line, the kids will ask you, "Mom, Dad, what have you been doing in your life before us? What were you doing? You know, kids, they want to know the history. I wonder if prostitutes will tell their kids, "I was a prostitute." It's shameful. There are so many things that we can do in this world. So you find even God is against prostitution. And then in verse 19, he said, "You shall not bring a prostitute's fee or the price of a dog." It's like he's comparing the prostitutes with a dog to the house of the Lord your God for any vow, because both of them are an abomination to the Lord your God. So whatever you get out of your prostitution, or I mean, be it billions, trillions, even if you take it to the house of God, that is between you and the maybe the pastor or whoever you are, you'll be praised as usual. You know, in the world we live in nowadays, when somebody gives a lot in church, even if he's a mega thief, he's praised. But there's only one person who knows your heart. He doesn't even recognize it. In fact, he turns his head away. He doesn't even want to imagine that you're bringing money from some things he said you should not do. So you have to be careful of what you're bringing before the Lord, the Most High God. And then if we go to verse 22 and 23, when you make a a vow to the Lord your God, you shall not delay in paying it, for the Lord your God will demand of it of you, and it will be counted as a sin for you if you don't pay the vow. And then verse 23, he gives you softer landing spots. But you shall refrain from making vows. If you refrain from making vows, you will have no sin. This thing about vowing, I remember I talked about it in one of the videos before. God says, God hates stupid vows. Don't make a vow. Don't say, I'm going to build this church. I'm going to build the toilet for the church. Bring the chairs, and you don't do it. You promise things, you don't do it. Don't be coerced into vowing, and you know you can't make it. God understands if you can't pay, it's good, but he knows your heart. So this vow, in the vowing thing, you can see even this about vowing was so serious. If you look in a First Samuel chapter 1, it's about Hannah was a barren woman and she didn't have any kids. She used to cry unto God. She really cried because she wanted kids, but there was no way that, I mean, her husband had another wife. The wife had sons, and this wife used to mock Hannah proper, big time. So in 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verse 11, you see, is it chapter, yeah, 1 Samuel chapter 1, yeah, come on, okay, chapter 1 and verse 11, Hannah vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou shalt will indeed look on the affliction of thine handmaid, and you remember me, and forget that not thine handmaid, but will give unto thine handmaid a man child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. She went to church, to the temple, and prayed because she was hurting. After that, she got a son, and get your guess is as good as mine. The son was Samuel. Samuel was so blessed because he was dedicated to the Lord. That was a vow unto the Lord. Obviously, imagine if Hannah had not, after giving birth to Samuel, she could just said, no, now let's carry on with life. Maybe Samuel could have survived. Maybe he could have even died after a few months. But Hannah kept her vow. Keeping a vow is so important. And then there's another part, another vow here. That's why you say we have to be careful with the type of vows that we keep. If we go to Judges chapter 11 and verse 30 to 31. There was this guy, his name was Jephthah. He was a mighty man of valor, war, but he was a son of a prostitute, a harlot. So, there's this man who brought him to live with him, but the other sons chased this guy away from that village, so he went to another city. But later on, he became, there are so many, he joined, became a strong man with a strong army. And then one day, the Israelites came to seek his hand to help them, so that he can help the Israelites fight the enemies, because the enemies were always fighting, the Ammonites were always fighting the Israelites, killing them, so they needed somebody to help them. That's why you say, that's why I believe wherever you are right now, don't despise where you are. You see that you're struggling. Your mother was, I don't know who, I mean your village, in your village there's nothing else, nothing good that has come out of your village. But you don't know the plans of God. So this guy, the Israelites came, took him, he agreed with them, and then they told him, if you go fight the our enemies for us, you will be our leader. And that's what he did. But before he fought the enemies, there's a vow that he made unto the Lord. That was in verse 31. 30 to 31. And Jephthah vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, we have to be very careful on what we say unto the Lord, vowing. If thou shalt without fail deliver the children of Ammon into mine hands, then it shall be that whatsoever cometh forth of the doors of my house to meet me when I return in peace from the children of Ammon, shall surely be the Lord's, and I will offer it up for a burnt offering. Jephthah was going for war, and he made a vow to God. If you give me these people into my hands, if I win this war, when I go back home, the first thing that comes out of the of my house, be it a, I think in his mind he was like a doe, a cow, sheep, horses, camels. But he said the first thing that comes, he will dedicate it unto the Lord and he'll give it as a burnt offering. That's why I keep saying, I'm repeating again, you have to be extremely careful on what you're promising God. And then in verse number 32, Jephthah passed over unto the children of Ammon to fight against them, and the Lord delivered them to his hands. So he won the war, and he smote them all completely. In verse 34 to 35, and Jephthah came to Mizpeh unto his house. You know, he's won the war. Now he's going, it's payback time now. The Lord has helped you. He went into his house, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him with timbrels and with dances, and she was his only child. Beside her, he had neither son nor daughter. And it came to pass, when he saw her, he rent his clothes and said, alas, my daughter, thou hast brought me very low, and thou art one of them that trouble me. For I have opened my mouth unto the Lord, and I cannot go back. So, you know, those days, they used to sacrifice. The laws were so tight. So this girl was a virgin girl, and she agreed to that command of the Lord. So she said she has to go for a month or 2 months with her friends into the mountains to mourn and weep, because it was the end of her life. So you find, the thing is, here, it's just about vowing. We have to be very, very careful. Don't be misled. Before you do anything in the kingdom of God, you have to think You have to think hard. And then let's go to there's another let's go to verse 24 to 26. 24 it says, observe and do what is emitted from your lips, just as you have pledged to the Lord your God as a donation, which you have spoken with your word. When you enter into your neighbor's vineyard, you may eat as many grapes as you desire until you are sated, that's satisfied, but you shall not put any into your vessel, that's a bag, or cut the food. When you enter into your neighbor's standing grain, you may pick the ears with your hand, but you shall not lift a sickle upon your neighbor's standing grain. This is another one, another interesting law, of which I think even it pertains even today in the world we are living in. Because I remember I used to, there was a place in the coastal region of Kenya, in Kenya, we used to work there. And we were passing through villages and we were hungry. There were fruits. The farmer had fruits. So what he told us, he just told us, you can eat as much as you want, but don't carry them. I mean, it's a law, an unwritten law. It's just, and he was a very old man. And that old, the way I looked at him, he was like, he doesn't know how to write, to read, but he understands. If you look at the Old Testament, these are the things that they knew since they were kids. When somebody comes, let them eat. Don't let somebody go hungry. Feed them and let them go. And also you can see, in Matthew 12:1, you find when Jesus was walking with his disciples. In Matthew chapter 12 and verse 1, you find when Jesus was walking, at that time, Jesus went on the Sabbath day through the corn, and his disciples. His disciples were hungered and began to pluck the ears of the corn and to eat. When the Pharisees saw it, they said unto him, behold, the disciples do that which is not lawful to do upon on a Sabbath day. You see, here the disciples also, that was not, it's just a law from the Old Testament, and it goes on even today. Those disciples, they used to pick the ears of the corn and then they eat. That was not their, it wasn't their farm, it wasn't their garden, they were passing by. And you see, nobody was stopping them. But unfortunately, in this case, you find the Pharisees, they were just going after Jesus. These guys, they were just following. They wanted to trap Jesus, but it was so hard. But you can see these disciples, they went through a farm and they picked and they were eating. So it's not a sin. Only that they were not putting them in their bags. So that's why I say, I love the word of God. It opens up our ears, our minds, our hearts and souls. And may the Lord keep on opening it up so that we understand each and everything that's going on. In Yeshua's mighty name, amen and amen. If you're there, and you don't know anything about the Most High God, and you want to be part of the kingdom, you want to know, how do these Christians live? Who is this Jesus? Who is this Yeshua? And who is Adonai? Who is this Jehovah? Who is this King of Kings, mighty in battle, who can protect me with my family, my children, my parents? Who is this Lord? I want to know him. Say these words after me. Father, Lord, I come before you. I am a sinner. I have sinned against you and against everyone. Forgive me of all my sins. Cleanse me. I confess that Jesus is Lord. He died on the cross for me, for my sins, and now I'm a free man. I'm part and parcel of the kingdom of God. Thank you, God, for receiving me in your kingdom, in Adonai's kingdom, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. If you say that prayer, the Lord is with you. The Lord is happy. The angels are rejoicing. You don't know what you've just done. Join a church near you. Start reading the Bible. Your life will never be the same again. And then may the Lord bless you mightily. And for my viewers back there at home, wherever you are, Lord bless them. Open their minds, their hearts. Let them know your laws and commands. Let them understand them with simplicity. Let them not complicate things. Let no one come and complicate your word for them, making it look impossible. Father Lord, let them understand it as they read their Bible. Let them understand it slowly by slowly. Holy Spirit of God, touch them mightily, their minds and their brains. And for those who are sick out there, O Father, I decree healing in Jesus' mighty name. Touch them, O Lord, from the top of their head to the sole of their feet. All the veins in their bodies, the bones, the skin, the rashes, whatever sickness my brother or sister is going through out there, our children, our parents, Father Lord, touch them. If they believe in you, if only they believe in you and they have faith in you, they are healed in Jesus' name. You are healed in Jesus' name. Whatever sickness it is. Thank you, Jesus. I can feel it. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Yehlantuku bahana. Shelka maratul kemen. Abol konthal kentar halabena beno. Yahanta Yeshua. In Yeshua's mighty name, you're healed from the top of your head to the sole of your feet. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen and amen. God bless you guys. May his countenance shine upon you. Thank you guys. See you next time. Share, comment, like, and also you can watch on YouTube. When you share it on YouTube, you comment on YouTube, the better we are moving further. We are widening our horizon. Let's spread it on YouTube and everywhere about the kingdom of the Most High, King Adonai. See you next time, and God bless you. Amen and amen and amen.